Dinosaur Planet, not to be confused with Planet Dinosaur or Planet of Dinosaurs, is a four-part miniseries made by Discovery Channel. Each of the four episodes depicts life in the Cretaceous period in different parts of the world with different kinds of dinosaurs, while cutting back to present day every once in a while to hear from scientists about the subject of the episodes. The real strong suit of this series, as opposed to others of its genre, is its storytelling aspect. Each episode has a main dinosaur character, and the plot sets them on journeys that serve as a means for the audience to see other creatures and certain prehistoric occurrences, ranging from volcanic activity to predatory hunts to evolutionary flukes. All of them are structured very well, and always keep you interested in what's going to happen to the dinosaur characters next. Another big way that this one stands out is with the dinosaur designs. They're far more bright and eye-catching than some of the duller ones seen in other dinosaur documentaries, with each episode seeming to have its own predominant color palette to set them apart, a very clever way of giving the different episodes their own uniqueness. Not only that, but the dinosaur designs themselves are much more original and actually a lot closer to what paleontologists know they looked like than with some other documentaries. Many of the small carnivores have feathers, the ones with scales are extremely detailed, and there's one particular carnivore with backward-pointing arms and hands. There's also countless dinosaurs and other prehistoric animals that have never been used in documentaries before, many of which I didn't know existed when I first saw it as a kid, like Notosuchus, Orodromius, Tarascosaurus, and tons more. I really think more dinosaur documentaries should take after the strengths of this one. Unfortunately, there are some problems, perhaps most notably with the narration by Christian Slater. I know I've said this before in some of my other reviews, but I really don't like it when documentaries cast famous actors as narrators, because the narration isn't supposed to be a performance. The unnecessary inflections in the voice distract from the actual documentary.
Allodapasuchus, a long name for predators short on brains, but totally fearless in battle.
As for the script itself, there are a few silly moments where things like this are said.
Well, maybe. And stay away! I gotta give him credit for trying.
But, on the other hand, there are some actually poetic lines like this.
The Troodons are the first victims of the dark force that rules a volcanic kingdom. His second day adrift ends in total exhaustion, and a sleep as dark and deep as the sea.
So, overall, the narration is kind of a mixed bag. One other unfortunate shortcoming of the series is the CGI. Even though, like I said before, the colors are carefully chosen and the designs are great, the movements and the way they intermingle with the real-life backgrounds aren't 100% convincing most of the time. There's many noticeable errors, like animals walking across sand and dirt without leaving any footprints. The only noticeable use of practical effects is in one scene with a couple of raptors, but the models really don't look alive at all. And there's even noticeable differences with their CGI counterparts, like how their lips don't cover their teeth when they close their mouths. But all of that said, it never gets to a point where the narration or the visuals are so bad that it could be called terrible. It's pretty easy to get used to before long, and you can immerse yourself in the style that it's going for. The episode White Tip's Journey takes place in the Gobi Desert and follows a velociraptor named White Tip as she at first struggles to survive without a pack, and then later how she comes to be accepted by a new pack. Jurassic Park made Velociraptor famous, but technically the real-life creature didn't look so much like it did in the movies. The episode even acknowledges this in one of the paleontology segments.
In Jurassic Park, the fleet-footed Velociraptor raced out of nowhere to become one of the world's most famous dinosaurs. However, the Velociraptor was actually less than one half my size.
Although there are still some inaccuracies with the Velociraptors in this show, it is still nice to see a version closer to the real thing. I like the arrangement of feathers and the slender, bird-like body design, and even the detail of giving males and females noticeable differences in color. Other feathered dinosaurs are showcased in the episode as well, my favorite of which being the Oviraptor. I always liked the scaly, slender look of older depictions when I was younger, but this strange, fuzzy design was so bizarre and so unexpected when I first saw it that it made me like this dinosaur even more so, and the honking bird noises they use for sound effects match so well. Another surprise comes at the end when a major Velociraptor character actually turns out to be part of the famous fossil where a Protoceratops and Velociraptor are locked in battle, seemingly having died at the exact same time. I'll never forget how amazed and impressed I was when I saw that ending for the first time. The next episode, Pod's Travels, focuses on the subject of island dwarfism, and the way they present it through storytelling is actually really clever, taking a pyroraptor named Pod, who gets swept away into the sea and ends up being marooned on an island with similar dinosaurs to his homeworld, but smaller. As we learn from the paleontology cutaways, evolution sometimes causes animals to shrink as generations pass due to limited space and resources on islands. So what we end up seeing is pretty much a prehistoric version of Gulliver's Travels, which they even seem to acknowledge. This episode has a really good sense of story structure, setting up the main dinosaur character in his homeland, establishing each of the major dinosaurs he shares his world with, and then, after the inciting action takes him to the island, we see each of the same creatures in miniature versions, including Pod himself, as he becomes the leader of a new pack of carnivores just because of how big he is. It also does a great job of making you sympathize with Pod as he struggles in vain to find others of his own kind, even mistaking his own echoes for another raptor. It's so sad because such a social creature will never be with his own species again, and even more so, he's just an animal and isn't capable of figuring out why. It makes for a bittersweet ending where he essentially becomes the new dominant predator of the island, but the trade-off is he'll be alone for the rest of his life. The poetic narration almost writes itself. Aside from the plot, another big strength is the design of the pyroraptor. The red feathers are, appropriately enough, very fiery looking, and they look a lot more realistic than the velociraptor feathers from the previous episode. Little Das's hunt is a bit different from the rest of the series, as there really isn't one main dinosaur character this time around. The title is named after a particular baby Daspletosaurus, although he's not necessarily the main focus throughout. There's also a pair of Mayasaurs named Buck and Blaze, and a few other creatures on the side like Quetzalcoatlus, Troodon, and my favorite of the series, Aineasaurus. I've always thought the Ceratopsian group of dinosaurs besides the famous Triceratops deserved more recognition in pop culture, since there's so many bizarre species like this one that most people don't know about. Much like the T-Rexes in When Dinosaurs Roamed America, the Daspletosauruses in this episode are shown hunting in a pack as a family, with the youngest, Little Das, scaring the prey into running towards the older siblings, which then chase the prey into the waiting jaws of the big and powerful mother. I like the way this episode shows the creatures in their daily lives, all while building up to an impending volcanic eruption. The ironic thing is that Little Das and his family are shown following Buck and Blaze towards the volcano, never suspecting that they'd do better to run in the opposite direction before it's too late. It's a pretty epic finale with pyroclastic flow engulfing everything and lava rocks raining from the sky. The final episode, Alpha's Egg, has a very clever idea of two opposing dinosaurs, Alpha, a Saltosaurus, and Dragonfly, an Alcosaurus, who cross paths throughout their lives until finally they meet in a final confrontation where only one of them comes out alive. It's a simple but clever idea. The way we see both of the dinosaurs growing up, dodging other creatures, and often narrowly escaping death is a lot of fun to watch. My favorite scene is towards the beginning when Alpha and hundreds of other baby Saltosauruses run through the woods while predators jump in from the sides and grab them, but their safety in numbers ensures their survival, like with so many modern-day animals. The music from this part is also cool to listen to. Something else I like is the use of the giant predator Carcharodontosaurus. They do a great job of making these things look big and heavy, with distorted elephant roars for their voices. All around, Dinosaur Planet is a very unique entry in the dinosaur documentary genre, and just goes to show that BBC aren't the only ones who can make an enjoyable, educational dinosaur series. Like with almost all the others, there's a few nitpicks here and there, but it overall turns out a great product, with immersive visuals, new dinosaur faces, and a step in the right direction of creating entertaining stories to complement the informative side of dinosaurs. Definitely worth checking out.